day, ladies and gentlemen. I tried to embrace technology and set my mobile phone with a timer to keep me on time, but I couldn't simply look out of the other that it had making a noise, so I'm having to resort to an old-fashioned watch, and I will try and keep an eye on it. I want you to imagine the scene. You're in the south of England, it's a hot summer's day. You've been round one of the superb country houses for which Britain is renowned. You've had just about enough time since lunch to contemplate a cream tea. And it's actually very important for me to point out this is a correct photograph of the cream tea, which has jam on after the cream. And those who... there's obviously a Devonian up there somewhere. There's a rivalry in our country. It's quite good it's only about cream teas, and we haven't yet come to battle over it. But nevertheless, there was great shock when the Queen put jam on first, to those of us who believe in this way of doing it. So I'm making a point by putting this up here. Of course, as well, as everybody who knows Britain, and obviously there are several here from the response to that, will know, it's sunny all day and every day in England. Well, maybe not. And I don't know why this fellow is looking quite so pleased with himself. We actually have very high rainfall, and indeed, in recent years, we have been getting much more severe downpours of rain, coupled with very strong winds. And in this case, this was a flood at ground level in 2007. But we also have to be very concerned about the state of our roads. And in fact, we have to actually not only keep them in good condition, but we have to allow for more water to be able to get away. Otherwise, there's a great risk to our buildings. The National Trust for England, Wales and Northern Ireland, and I say that purposefully because the National Trust for Scotland is a separate organisation, and it's very important that the distinction is understood, cares for 200 or more great houses or equivalently large buildings. Unfortunately, they're not all conveniently gathered together, as you might imagine from this. This is rather wonderful Capriccio done in the 1980s. On average, a roof requires replacing every 80 to 100 years. And I say that having studied some of the records of houses in terms of when the works happened. So I'm reasonably confident about that. That, of course, relies on the works being done properly in the first place. That means that with the number of houses we have in the National Trust, at least two houses need to be made. Have their roof overhauled, substantially overhauled, completely roofing every year if we're to keep on top of our responsibilities. In the past, the approach tended to be that the house would be closed to the public during that time, or if it was able to remain open, then the budgets were adjusted downwards because it was assumed that fewer people would actually want to visit the houses during that time, a very defeatist approach, I'm sure you will agree. In recent years, that has been changing, and the project that I'm going to be talking to you about is, I think, the furthest point we've got on that journey, where we actually decided that with the prospect of the work that's been done, we had to embrace the works and actually make them part of the offer to the public. And indeed, we were proved right. It was a gamble. We had to put substantial additional funds into that, so it's a financial gamble as well as a reputational one. In fact, it cost probably about £400,000 more on a bill of £5.4 million to undertake this approach rather than the former way of doing things. And I just want to particularly draw attention to the Association for Heritage Interpretation. This is the page from their website. And at the base, where it says that it goes to a project that took the opportunity of major renovation works to dust off their approach, particularly like that, because the National Trust, as with many of our organisations, spends its whole time controlling dust on objects. So the idea that we're also now controlling dust on interpretation is a very satisfying place to be. and that it goes on by introducing new and dynamic interpretive methods and fully implementing the idea that everything you do on site can and should be interpreted. And I feel very passionately about that personally. Because if we can't infuse the public with why we're doing the work we do, then ultimately we would not be sustainable. Vyne in Hampshire is in a beautiful rural part of southern England, about an hour's drive to the east of London. And it has at its core the remains of a great Tudor palace. And I show a reconstruction here, and you'll see why in a minute, because it doesn't look like this now. But it is still very much at the core. You can also get a bit of a sense of it from a detail from underneath somebody's arm on a portrait on the right-hand side in the 17th century before it was substantially changed. It was built for William Lord Sandys, who was Lord Chamberlain to Henry VIII, that great name that conjures up so many almost Game of Thrones-like pictures in our minds, with heads rolling all over the place. And he was also Constable of Calais and a great military leader. We have no face-on portrait of Lord Sandys, so I put up here a back view of him on the left-hand side in the back row when he was in the garter ceremony, and then a frieze from Rouen depicting the meeting of the kings at the Field of the Cross of Gold, and he must be one of the characters immediately behind the king. So, unfortunately, we haven't been able to identify exactly which one. The house, although altered, retains two of the most important Tudor interiors in England. This is the Oak Gallery, which has superb contemporary carved panelling with devices, Tudor devices from the royal family and the nobility. And you can see Catherine of Aragon's pomegranate and Sandys' own winged goat in this image. And then the chapel, which has been described by Professor Maurice Howard as being of the standard not found at the time outside the royal palaces of England. And particularly magnificent is the Flemish stained glass, one panel of which I show up here, which depicts Henry VIII, Catherine of Aragon, and Henry's sister, Margaret of Scotland, with their patron saints. And extraordinarily, that stained glass scheme was in place on one of Henry's four visits when Catherine of Aragon was queen, and it remained in place when he came back with Anne Boleyn in 1535. Whether they just brushed over that, I mean, they were at sufficient distance perhaps not to realise that the opposition queen was still up there. The house was bought by the Trent family in the 17th century and reduced and altered and remodelled, and in the bottom left-hand side, and the red outlining shows you the Tudor bits that survive. They also altered internally, and that's significant in their own right, some of the interiors, but ultimately what is most significant architecturally and historically is the Tudor lair. By 2014, the roof was in a terrible condition. There were slates slipping, water was getting inside and damaging internal surfaces, and as you can see on the right-hand side, the chimneys were at peril of falling. And it was actually a very great storm in January 2014 that finally made the Trust Road. They had to do something about it. It was a crisis situation. So in 2015, the funding was put, or rather, the decision was made to go ahead, and some funding was put in by the National Trust, given how important it was to get this done, and then fundraising also was undertaken. Because the upper floor would have to be closed, it was felt that we absolutely had to make the ground floor work as hard as possible and engage people who were coming round so that they enjoyed the opportunity. And I should say that we know that was very successful from feedback, which I'll come on to a bit at the end, but also from the fact that our visitor numbers, rather than going down, as has often been expected with building works, went up by 56,000 to 220,000 in the year, or 18 months that the roof project was underway. We also were absolutely determined that scholarship and research should be at the basis, and good understanding should be at the basis of everything we did. And with Susanna Austin as our interpretation director, we gathered together academics from four or five universities. And you can see here some of the sessions. Top left, obviously absolutely critical at British meetings of this type in the heritage sector, that there's cake and tea. And also there's some cake and fruit, and not as most of the fruit is still in the bowl, whereas the cakes are being very much consumed. And then on the bottom left, you see we did also sink to our knees. We weren't actually praying at that point. We were trying to understand what Henry's view would have been from the closet, because he would not have been in the principal part of the chapel when he attended Mass. He would have been in his own closet above. So to try to understand that. So we physically got grips with the space as well. One of the great strokes of good fortune from this was our introduction to Dr. Lucy Kaufman from Oxford University, who is a great expert in Henry VIII and Henry VIII's England, and I'll let her speak for herself on this.
So in 1535, Henry VIII comes as part of one of his summer progresses. Now, progresses are part and parcel of being a monarch in the 16th century. In the summertime, the king and most, or the queen eventually, and most of their court would go out into the countryside and stay at royal houses and the houses of important courtiers all over the kingdom. This gave the court a chance to clean up the London courts, which of course, after having 1,400 people living in them, got very messy. There was sort of no way to clean them up properly. But it also gave the chance for the monarch to have contact with his subjects. In a time when there was no media, really, it gave a chance for the experience of the monarchy, the experience of the power of the crown throughout the kingdom to spread it out. So Henry VIII going on a progress was just part and parcel of being a monarch at the time he was. But 1535 is a particularly special an important progress, because it happens right at the moment of the initial Reformation. Henry VIII leaves London just after Sir Thomas More is executed for refusing to say that the king is the head of the church, not the pope. He leaves and he travels throughout the southeast of England, trying to spread this new, what we now call a Protestant message. He stops in important areas. He even consecrates really fundamentally important bishops, some of whom end up executed under the realm of his daughter, not too far away from where we're standing here today. So this is a chance to tour with Anne Boleyn, his new wife, a chance to really cement Protestant loyalty throughout the southeast. And a tour is extended because there's a horrible plague that hits London. One of the worst plagues in a decade hits London and he can't go back. So he uses this as an opportunity, one, to do a little hunting. Henry loves to hunt. It's his favorite form of exercise, especially in his later years. He stops jousting, he starts hunting. So it gives him a chance to have a little fun, but it also gives him a chance to secure the loyalty of a few people who are wavering in their support of the Reformation. And key amongst this is Sands, who owns the Vyne. Sands is a major military commander, and there are rumors. The imperial ambassador is writing to the Holy Roman Emperor saying, Sands may start a revolution, against Henry. One of the things that Henry does in his trip to the Vyne is to remind Sands that his power is based on Henry's power, and that his support is key to Henry's support. And I really think that this moment at the Vyne helps keep Sands on side, because some of the other people mentioned in that letter by the imperial ambassador do end up rebelling against Henry in the next couple of years. It gets put down, it doesn't work, but Sands stays on side. And as a very experienced military commander and a very respected member of Henry's court, it's incredibly important that he remains loyal.
So we decided to seize this opportunity of the house being disrupted to bring out this incredibly important aspect. We're working with Stellan, the museum designers, and Christopher Byrne, an artist. We came up with these graphics, and also you notice the painting of the hoarding to evoke those great tinted campments that are filled with copper gold and so forth. and then inside we had a display to help to evoke the court of Henry VIII, and Lucy Carrington had been very potent in her description of that, and also the fact that this, she said rather poignantly, this was the last time that Anne Boleyn was truly happy. She was pregnant again, her husband adored her, Protestantism was in the ascendancy, and she was very passionate about that, and the rumours had not yet started about her. So we wanted to get the sense of the court in this country house and what it felt like. And one of the ways we did that, and I mean, in terms of one, is through using tapestries to create an animation, and I'll show a short clip from that. Fulfillment, I Will Bring You, which was in Anne Boleyn's own songbook, and therefore very potent to be used in this situation. In the rooms immediately before the display about the Tudor court, we concentrated on what happens to a house such as the Vyne when it is under work such as this, and use it again as an opportunity to highlight objects that normally might be seen at quite a distance. So we had some more museum displays at the bottom, so that you could really focus on very significant objects, and then also artistic arrangements of them, so that the light fittings and mirrors were all gathered together to the design of the project curator, Kate Adam Kim Ross. And then in the room subsequently, we looked at how in the 19th century, the then owner of the Vyne actually made huge personal sacrifice in order to preserve the place at that point. That was the last time there was a major re-roofing, so we looked at that. But the culmination of the visit to the interior of the house was the chapel. And actually, I should also point out that we sort of followed on the, sort of the scaffolding language in terms of the basis that we put our interpretation on in the house. We had Henry VIII's lowering presence in the closet that he would have occupied. And then We've dressed the altar according to contemporary images and indeed a contemporary inventory of the chapel. And then I'll just play another short film that will show you about the creation of the Mass of 1535, which would have been experienced by Henry, and the music which came from a book from Henry's own possession, and this is the first time it was ever recorded. You're not going to hear it actually recorded.
The chance to change this space into an immersive experience so you can feel what it would have felt like to be in this space on that cusp of the Reformation, the autumn of the late medieval church. As a historian, we don't get that chance very often to time travel. And I think what this chapel will let us all do, visitors and historians alike, is to time travel, to get a real sense of what it would have been like to stand in that chapel in October of 1535 and to worship alongside Henry VIII. And that is beyond compare an exciting moment.
The task for me is specifically to think about what's going on when Henry VIII is there, brings his vast entourage of courtiers and servants, including members of the Chapel Royal who are travelling with him on the progress, and to think, what would they have done, how would they have done it, and what resources do we now have in terms of surviving books and surviving music, which would enable us to give us a good impression.
The effect that we're trying to create is one of reality, but the end of the day is just an illusion, it's just an audio illusion. My job is to ensure that that illusion is correct, is believable. We're trying to record everything, all the performers very close, without any reverberation, so that when we play it back in the chapel, it's a very believable experience.
It's a very powerful experience to be in that space, and the sound engineers broadcast the sound from the relevant part of the chapel, so you really do get a sense of being in amongst it. Then the conclusion of the works is the roof, was the roof, it's now completed, I'm glad to say, but we were determined that people should be able to get up there. It added a lot to the cost, but my goodness, it was well worthwhile, hugely well received, accessible to all, so realtors and the tiny tots could also get up there. They could look out, they could look at the works, and just a TripAdvisor comment, and I'll just write the last sentence. I can't tell you how fascinating this experience is. Go now, do not miss this chance, and while you're at it, buy a tile and customize it for posterity. Thank you very much.